Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to the inaugural John Mansfield lecture, which, although the first lecture tonight marks the 10th birthday of the University of South Australia Law School, it will become an annual event, and obviously it will focus on areas of expertise that John focused on throughout his very distinguished career. I'd just like to acknowledge, first and foremost, that we are meeting tonight on the lands of the Kaurna people, and we're very fortunate to have Frank Wanganeen here this evening to provide a welcome to country. Mr. Wanganeen was named the Premier's NAIDOC Award winner for 2017 for significant contribution to the lives of Aboriginal South Australians through his commitment to reconciliation, social justice and the preservation of Kaurna heritage, culture and language. Will you please welcome Frank Wanganeen?
I'll just start and just put my glasses on, so just bear with me for a minute. So, I'm really sort of pleased to be here at this lecture here with John Mansfield. And I suppose it's the 10th year of the birthday from the business law school. So, happy birthday. and keeping with the theme, anniversaries, and I just want to go through just a few little sort of milestones that for Aboriginal people, and I'll just name off a few anniversaries. We've got the 23rd anniversary of 1994 Native Title, and then we've got the 45th anniversary of the 1972 Tent Embassy, and the 78th anniversary of 1939 Kamagunja walk-off from in Victoria across the River Murray, and on February the 9th we had the anniversary of the National Apology to the Stolen Generation, and in March, 36th anniversary of the Pitjantjatjara Land Rights Act in 1981. That's an inaugural statutory lands right ascended to the Yunkandjara and Pitjantjatjara people over their traditional lands. And, we got the 1967 referendum, and I think that's about 50 years that we've recognise Aboriginal people as citizens of this country. So, that's been a big thing. And like reconciliation, and like I said, I've been really sort of privileged to be, involved with that movement. And just recently we had the breakfast in the convention centre, and, it just gets bigger and bigger every year. So, from my journey, there's been a lot of, people becoming more conscious about Aboriginal issues, and which is really good, and people wanting to learn about Aboriginal culture. So in saying that, and, part of my journey too is about learning the language. So now I'll just do the welcome to country in the Kaurna language. Ngāi Tāmpiti Tūwila Burkiana, Ngāi Tāmpiti Bambavan Urendi, Kaurna Yurtiana, Marichiyanga Kaurna Miana, Ngāi Wagandi Māni Ngāi Budni Kaurna Yurtiana. So what I just said is that I just want to acknowledge the ancestors and also recognise where we hold in this event is on Kaurna country, and on behalf of the Kaurna people, I'd just like to welcome you to Kaurna country. So nā te ia. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Frank. I'd just like to, before I formally introduce the Vice-Chancellor to come up and introduce our guest of honour, acknowledge the presence this evening of a number of distinguished people, starting with, obviously, our guest of honour, the Honourable John Mansfield AMQC, his wife Kate and his family and friends, including Gemma and Andy, who have come all the way from New York for this evening and for yesterday's events. I'd like to welcome the Vice-Chancellor, Professor David Lloyd, the Honourable Justice Michael Barker of the Federal Court, the Honourable Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of South Australia, Christopher Caracas, Justice Kevin Nicholson, Judge Katrina Bochner, and other judges and Master of the Supreme Court. I'd also like to welcome members of the Council and senior management of the University of South Australia. And thank you all for coming out on such a cold, wintry night to attend our first inaugural John Mansfield lecture. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Professor Wendy Lacey. I'm the Dean of Law here at UniSA, and it's an absolute honour to be hosting this event this evening. I just have to go through a few housekeeping matters. Obviously, in the event of an emergency, there are exits to the left and right at the front, and there's also an exit at the back of the room if you need to leave. And we are also recording tonight's presentation, so if you could all, if you haven't already done so, please either switch off or put your phone on silent. Thank you. So let me introduce Professor David Lloyd, who we're delighted to have here this evening. David Lloyd was appointed to the University of South Australia as Vice-Chancellor and President in 2012. A Dublin-born and educated chemist who specialises in computer-aided drug design, Professor Lloyd has refocused institutional culture to position UniSA as Australia's University of Enterprise and to shape its activities to better meet the challenges of the 21st century. In 2014, Professor Lloyd was appointed to the South Australian Economic Development Board, a past chair of the Australian Technology Network Group of Universities. He now sits on the board of Universities Australia, which is the peak body representing the university sector, where he is the lead Vice-Chancellor for Research and Innovation. Before joining the University of South Australia, Professor Lloyd was Vice President for Research and later Bursar and Director of Strategic Innovation at Trinity College in Dublin. Professor Lloyd was Chair of the Irish Research Council and prior to academia worked in the pharmaceutical industry in the UK. He holds an honorary professorship from Tianjin University and is a Fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry. Please join me in welcoming Professor Lloyd.
Thanks, Wendy. I'm not sure why my biography has to be read out when I'm just going to introduce another person with their biography, but well, there we go. There's the formalities of Australia. Naganirna Miarna, Namarni Nanari David, Nayarta Yoku Yoku, Nakuntarinti Taikindi Naichi Wardli, Napudli Naicha, Nawagandi Warna Garna Miarna, Nipudli Naichu Kunyan Tapathi. Now, what I just said, my accent's not as good as Frank's because it's an Irish accent in Garna there. Hello, my name is David. I'm not originally from this country. I'm very proud to call it my home. And I tell you this in the language of the Garna people as a sign of my respect. Good evening, honoured guests, ladies and gentlemen. John. Before his retirement last year, the Honourable John Mansfield was the Honourable Justice Mansfield, a federal court judge who sat on the court's South Australian registry. He has had a distinguished legal career in native title and competition law, a career where he demonstrated a strong sense of service and commitment both to the law and to the wider community. John was appointed to the Federal Court shortly after the Native Title Act came into place, and his judicial work on native title claims is considered an important addition to this area of law. In 2011, he broke new ground by settling 12 major native title claims covering more than 30,000 square kilometres across the Victoria River District in the Northern Territory near the Western Australia border. I would like to point out that's a landmass about half the size of the island of the nation on which I was born. So it's kind of breathtaking when you consider that John's court granted that determination by consent, without the need for a long and expensive trial. This land is among the most productive cattle-growing country in the nation, and the territory government and the station owners accepted the claimant groups held rights there. That decision helped claim backlogs and accelerate decisions on native title rights across the territory and led to John becoming the Aboriginal Land Commissioner for the Northern Territory. In this inaugural lecture to mark UniSA's Law School's 10th birthday, the Honourable John Mansfield will talk about the effectiveness of the Native Title Act 1993 to date, including an assessment of compensation for Indigenous land rights taken away and the challenges and options for future effective recognition of Indigenous land rights. His influence in this area comes from a deep understanding of how Aboriginal law and customs operate, of how the language of Aboriginal people communicates the ideas that inform the subtleties and importance of concepts of connection of people and communities to the land. At the ceremonial sitting of the full court held to farewell John Mansfield, The Chief Justice, the Honourable James Alsop AO, spoke of John's understanding of the deep importance to this nation of the careful and sympathetic application of the legislation. His use of the word sympathetic, he added, was meant to illustrate how John, because of the person he is, knew the importance of the recognition of the incalculable injustices committed in the past, requiring Australians as a whole to recognise their debt to the Aboriginal people of this land and to recognise their place as an integral part of the soul of the nation. Now, John tells a great story about communication in the latest issue of the UniSA Business Magazine. It's a story of hearing native title claims on country, where the federal court learned of the need for effective communication with the claimants so as to properly understand their evidence to give it the weight it rightly merits. Because proof of the current connection between the past and present is largely a matter of evidence which is given by the claimant themselves, it's vital to listen to the speaker to understand where the speaker is coming from, literally, culturally and intellectually. John is, as his colleagues and friend attested at his retirement celebration, a man of gentle strength, made effective by a wonderful sense of humour and a great warmth of personality. He's also something of a Renaissance man, extremely well connected in the art circles, as particularly to the Art Gallery of South Australia, for whom, as chairman of its foundation, John oversaw the acquisition of over 1,000 works of art valued at over $40 million, including his own gift of two Aboriginal works. And although he took his law degree from Adelaide University, ours not even being a twinkle in the Vice-Chancellor's eye at the time, he has become a stalwart of UniSA's Business School and our School of Law. He provided excellent advice during the initial establishment stage of the law school 10 years ago and is now chair of the school's advisory board. As his colleagues on the bench noted, this is a man who's made a huge contribution to South Australia, to the law, to justice, to the Aboriginal community, especially those in South Australia and in the Northern Territory. And they say he did all of this without ever seeking personal credit for anything. Yesterday, he told a charming story when he addressed the graduating classes of our Schools of Commerce, Marketing and Law. He spoke of his own end-of-year award, which was made to him in year two of primary school in 1956. In a raft of awards which was being given out to his classmates for best runners, best yard monitor, best chalkboard monitor, John was awarded best triangle player in the school band. Except there was no school band. There was no triangle, and everybody knew that. From humble beginnings, great achievements grow. Yesterday, we at UniSA expressed our gratitude for John's involvement with the business school in the way we know best. We conferred John with another set of initials to go with his AM and QC. We awarded him a DU UNIV, which is the Doctor of the University, an honorary doctorate of the University of South Australia, which is given to people of eminence who've made a distinguished contribution to public service, our field of academic endeavour, or artistic pursuit. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to the Honourable John Mansfield, AM, QC, Doctor of the University, whom we think would have made a wonderful triangle player had his school ever got around to organising the band.
Thanks, John. Well, how do you top that? Frank, thank you for the welcome to country. And like others, I recognise that we're on the traditional lands of the Kaurna people, and I pay my respects to your elders, past and present. Thank you to the UniSA and to the Law School for the opportunity to be involved in this university. Since I've been involved in it, I've been amazed and astounded at the energy with which it operates, the vision which it has, and the extent and the vigour with which it is building, as you've seen, along North Terrace and on Hiley Street. It is a truly exciting institution to be a part of, a great privilege to be there. Thank you, Wendy, for chairing. Thank you for your comments. And David, thank you for your comments. They're very flattering. It's very embarrassing, and they're largely overstated. John Kennedy, who many of you will have heard of, perhaps except the very young, had a saying which always appealed to me: some people see things the way they are and ask why. And some people see things the way they ought to be and ask why not. In the case of the Irish, including David, they see things the way they think they are and damn the truth. Well, that's what you heard a bit of tonight. I had a very good example of the Irish regard for truth and honesty when I was driving around Dublin with another man and his family one day, looking for a park, desperately looking for a park, because we were going to go to a pub and have a drink. Very abnormal thing to do in Dublin. And after a while, we just couldn't find the park near the place he wanted to go to, and he looked up. He said, "Lord, if you find me a park, I'll give up to drink." Well, 50 metres on, as we were driving along, a car pulled out, and there was this whopping great park just in front of us. And he looked up and said, "Lord, don't bother, I found it myself." Well, distinguished guests, those with an intimidating degree of knowledge and a wealth of knowledge greater than mine, and those who are distinguished because they're my friends and therefore it's very intimidating to talk to you anyway, thank you for coming. Thank you for your attention. It is, as you probably realise, a difficult task to give a lecture like this with such a mix of people, and I've decided that I won't try and teach the experts what they know. We've talked about it often enough, and that they're probably now much more expert than I am. So the story that I'm going to tell and what I'm going to comment about, I hope, is fairly accessible to everyone. I intend that this lecture, duly footnoted and with the irrelevant bits, will be published on the website of the university next week. For those of you who want to look at it in a serious way, you can do that. Now, the machine. We can't really start without understanding something about land rights. And what we can know, we all know, the description land rights is really quite an inadequate way of describing the relationship of Indigenous Australians to their country. Our concept of freehold title, our concept of land and our relationship to land is simply, as recognised in the common law, nothing anywhere near as deep and as intense and as genuine. So what I start with is a couple of quotes just to try and set the scene for the what I might call the visceral relationship that Aboriginal people have with their country. One of those quotes comes from a book by Bill Gammage called The Biggest Estate on Earth, How Aborigines Made Australia, published only a few years ago. And incidentally, developing a thesis about Aboriginal use of land before 1788, showing that it was sophisticated, very complex, very respectful, and very profitable. Some of you will have read of a book by Jared Diamond called Guns, Germs and Steel, in which he set out to show the evolution of different countries and the different Indigenous groups. And he said of the Australian Aborigines that one of the problems they had is that is why they didn't have a written language as much as we do, why they didn't build buildings in the way that the Europeans and some of the Africans were building buildings and the pyramids, was because the nature of the land was so harsh and the nature of the materials, the flora and the flora, was so difficult that they simply didn't have that opportunity. Bill Gammage's book and some much more recent literature shows that it was really quite wrong, that the Aborigines, when they were in Australia, in their own country, were actually very sophisticated people who managed the land in a very cultivated way. So that is changing the current or the previous perception about them. We go back to Mabo, to the land rights. You'll see in the High Court judgments enough to understand just how important land rights are to our Indigenous people. Which way do we go? Other way. Now, sorry, I'm a bit fast on the button. I thought I'd just start off by telling you how I'm going to progress through the process. So we're going to talk a little bit about some history, a bit about the Native Title Act, how it has approached the concepts which the Native Title Act introduces, and as the Native Title Act's function is to recognise native title or Indigenous rights in land in the context of that land. Finally, I want to look at where we've got to and talk about the challenges that we have in the future. So it's a difficult, an interesting task and an interesting path which I want to tell you about. Where have we been? Well, Captain Cook in 1770, as you no doubt remember, sailed up the eastern coast of Australia. He stopped at Botany Bay. He saw some Aboriginal people. He wasn't too impressed. He didn't engage much. He sailed, continued sailing, and eventually later that year, he put the British flag on Possession Island towards the northern part of Queensland and declared Australia a British territory. His instructions, with the relevant bit highlighted, were to do so with the consent of the natives. And if you look at his diaries, he took the view that there were no natives with whom he, or from whom he could seek consent, because they were too desultory, they were too sparse, they were too uninformed, there just wasn't enough of them to worry about. He thought there was no coherent society from whom he could get their consent or discuss how Australia might otherwise be settled. He was obviously wrong, and plainly wrong. It's an interesting thought to see what might have happened had he taken a different view. I haven't seen any special literature about that, though no doubt is some, but if you do comparative analyses of the British colonial settlements in the 17th century and in the 18th century, there isn't a great deal of basis for saying that there would have been an informed treaty or any other sort of arrangement that might have been set up. However, you will also know that the Canadian province was also being established, not precisely at the same time, but in the same sort of numbers of decades. And in fact, the British, as they were settling across Canada, did enter into treaties with a number of Indigenous tribes of the Canadian, what is now Canada, except to that when they got to British Columbia, that is the far west part, western part of Canada, where there is no treaty and where the British simply occupied, and the dealings and the legal system that operates in British Columbia in relation to recognition of native title rights is very similar to the history of Australia's. And you will know, of course, the New Zealand experience. The Treaty of Waitangi was in 1840, so we're talking about 70 years later and maybe 70 years better informed. So we start with the view of Cook that Australia was terra nullius, and our history shows that for all the time until 1992, over 200 years, we assumed that to be the case, at least in a legal sense. I don't want to go through the history of learning about Australian Indigenous rights, learning about how Australia, when I say we, I talk, I suppose, about the European settlement, dealt with or related to the Indigenous Australians. There's a range of different stories and every place was different. It's not a pretty history. You would know about the history wars, very relatively recently, Henry Reynolds on the one hand and Keith Windschuttle on the other. But as Frank mentioned, in 1992, Paul Keating, our Prime Minister, made a very famous speech at Redfern about that history, a history which we now come to accept. And in 2008, our then Prime Minister, Kevin Rudd, delivered the apology to Australia's Indigenous peoples. So the history really is very largely settled, and I can jump through the process of colonial settlement, the process of dispossession, to the more immediate steps which led to the Native Title Act and to the issue of land rights becoming a significant issue from about the 1960s. They're the big steps, and I'll come to those a little bit one by one. The Bark Petition in 1963 came from the people of Yirrkala. They actually have a consistent history of claiming land rights, and this was the start. They came from the northeast, and they are in the northeast of a northern territory of Australia, where a bauxite mine was proposed to be permitted. A lease was proposed to be granted, and it meant moving a very significant number of the people in Yirrkala away from where they were living, which was on a national park, and to be displaced in the interests of mining. So they established and sent the Yirrkala Bark Petitions to the Parliament. They presented them. They did no good. That print isn't very good, but of course, as you know, you can see those petitions in Parliament House. This is a bit slow jumping for me. The next step in 1966 was the Wave Hill walkout. Although it was really a strike by Aboriginal stockmen against their wages and conditions because they were discriminatorily poor, it did evolve into an expression of interest in the land and a claim for interest in the land. And many of you will remember that very iconic photograph of Prime Minister Gough Whitlam holding his hand out and pouring the soil into the hand of Vincent Lingiari, who was the leader of the Wave Hill walkout. Just incidentally, Frank mentioned a consent determination in 2011 of a large area of land in the Northern Territory, which was in that area, that is to the mid-east, northeastern part of the Northern Territory. When I was doing that, I met a man called Jimmy Wavehill, who is still alive and is a vibrant member, and he was part of that actual group who started the Wavehill walkout. It was at Gurindji Station, and because it's a little timely, I can also mention that another very famous Australian, Ted Egan, who you probably know pays the beer can, the beer box, and became the administrator of the Northern Territory. He's a very wonderful man and a musician. In 1967, he wrote a song called Gurindji Blues about the walkout, and it was recorded in 1971 by Ted Egan and Dr. G. Unipingo, the gentleman who's recently died, and I think that was his first recording, so it has a nice resonance when we go to that picture. Then, as Frank mentioned, we have had the 1967 referendum. So at a point when there's not much interest in land rights, and one might think not much interest in recognising the history of our Indigenous peoples, we had a referendum which recognised Indigenous Australians in a way which shamefully had not been done before. They could be included in the census as part of our population, and the Commonwealth was given power to pass laws specifically with respect to our Indigenous Australians for their betterment. It was a big step. The fact that it was so late is shameful. Over 90% of Australians voted in favour of that. So that is at least a very significant point of recognition. Then we had the Gove land rights. It is the same place as the Yirrkala people sent the Bark petitions in 1963. They wanted to stop the mining that was proposed there because it was their country. And they brought a case in the Supreme Court of the Northern Territory, which went for a few years and ended up in 1971 when Justice Blackburn decided that the law was that Australia was a terra nullius, the common law could not recognise Indigenous interests in land, and the claim was dismissed. There was no appeal. Sir Edward Woodward, who was one of the counsel in that case, then was given a job to inquire into that circumstance by Gough Whitlam, and in 1973 he presented the Woodward Royal Commission report. And that led in turn to the Aboriginal Land Rights Act of the Northern Territory. It was a very significant piece of legislation, but it was confined to the Northern Territory because that is the only area that the Commonwealth had power to legislate on that topic. What it did, and it didn't have too much take-up around Australia with other states and territories copying it, what it did was to say that where there is unalienated Crown land, if the Indigenous people could establish that they were traditional owners, and that wasn't a particularly onerous description, the Land Commissioner could recommend to the government that a grant of that land be made to those traditional owners. And the only impediment to that grant, subject to the ministerial discretion, was that the Minister also received a report from the Commissioner saying, these are the people who might be affected if you do make that grant. It's called a detriment report. As it's happened, that was very successful. And something like 50% of the Northern Territory of Australia is Indigenous owned under that legislation. So it was a very successful piece of legislation. It didn't hurt people in the sense that their interests were drastically adversely affected because by definition, it was crowned unalienated land, so there were no pastoral leases, there were no mining leases, there were no freeholds, so that was probably the peculiar nature of the Northern Territory to a degree has enabled that to be done. So that was the Land Rights Act. At the same time, and also very importantly, the Commonwealth passed the Racial Discrimination Act, which required equal treatment to all Australians in a number of respects, amongst other things, including in acquisition of land, so that when and if Indigenous land came to be recognised, or interest in land came to be recognised, it meant they were entitled to be compensated the same as everyone else, and that is part of the story. I should also say, because it's important to recognise, the Land Rights Act, passed by the Commonwealth, the Racial Discrimination Act, and some other legislation which came in at the same time, which was in a true sense liberal, it was protective of people in an appropriate way, initiated with the Whitlam government and was continued by the Fraser government under the Attorney General, then Bob Ellicott QC. So he maintained, and that package of legislation, including the establishment of the Federal Court, I might say, was part of that process of legislative continuance. Now, that concept was not picked up in the states other than South Australia. All states had some sort of legislation dealing with land rights in a very prescriptive or restrictive way. And as you also heard Frank say, in 1981, South Australia passed the APY, Anango Pitjantjatjara Yankunytjatjara Land Rights Act, giving in effect, Frank, about the top left-hand quarter of the state to those people, and that's been the case ever since. It was extended as an area of land in 1984. So that's something that South Australia did that no one else did. Other than that, the land rights process was largely ignored until this man came along, Eddie Mabo. He was a Meriam Islander from the Murray Islands in the Torres Strait. He sought to establish a claim for his rights in his country on behalf of his people as a Torres Strait Islander, and he was, in a sense, strategically in a better position than many of the Indigenous Australians, the Aboriginal Australians, because there had never been that type of acquisition of the Meriam Islands, or the Murray Islands, I should say, in the same way. So how did it go? Well, his case, as you know, was decided in 1992. In that 10-year period, Queensland, as a state, tried twice to frustrate him. Firstly, it tried to acquire the land, the subject of that claim, without payment and compulsorily acquire it. And of course, that might have been seen to be inconsistent with the Racial Discrimination Act, which I just explained. So in a case called Kawata against Bjelke Petersen, a name which you all know and love, Queensland challenged the validity of the Racial Discrimination Act, and as we all know, unsuccessfully. Well, Bjelke Petersen wasn't done. He then, in 1985, passed an act called the Coastal Islander Declaration Act, which had the effect of wiping out any property rights of the Torres Strait Islanders in their lands as and from 1879, with no compensation. So he was simply going to declare, in effect, that there never was a people on the Murray Islands or Torres Strait Islands who had any interest in land that the law should recognise. And in 1988, in the case which is called Mabo No. 1, that was declared invalid. Perhaps with the looking at it now, you say, how could you possibly even think that could have got up? But it was got up, and it got to the High Court, and the High Court said no to that. It was after that that the hearing of the Mabo case took place, first in Queensland and ultimately in the High Court, in what is one of its most significant, if not its most significant, judgments. Australian law was declared to recognise Indigenous communal interest in land, subject to what was called the radical title of the Crown. And if you read the Mabo case, you will see how vehemently the judges expressed and appeared to understand the nature of that relationship with country. That then led to the Native Title Act. In the period of a year or so, we had what many people called Mabo madness. There was a horror amongst many of the Australian community, not necessarily a significant majority, but a horror. They're coming in, they're taking our backyards, we'll have to move out of our houses. There was a serious negative campaign by significant people about doing anything about what the High Court had done and how terrible the High Court was. It's all described in a very interesting and fairly short book by Father Frank Brennan, many of you will have heard of, published in 1995, called Mabo Madness, Politics, One Land, One Nation. And as an epithet, One Land, One Nation, it has caught on and it is used now frequently, and it is something to which I think most people in the room would aspire to. So the Native Title Act was negotiated. It was negotiated in a fairly negative and vehement, passionate debate in the federal parliament. The Liberal Party was essentially opposed to the way in which it was to be done. But that was eventually passed, and the story of that process was also in Frank Brennan's book and is well worth a read. So it had those purposes. Did it get accepted? Western Australia this time then passed an act called the Western Australian Lands, Titles and Traditional Usage Act in 1995, and they said, well, we're a state, we can do this. To the extent to which the Native Title Act otherwise purports to interfere with our sovereignty, it's invalid. And part of that provision in the Western Australian Act, because of the way it was expressed, was also held by the High Court to be inconsistent with the Racial Discrimination Act, and so the Act was struck down. That's called, significantly, the Native Title Act case. So that decision in 1995 established, probably once and for all, the validity of the Native Title Act. There were some amendments in 1998 and some amendments in 2009, which I won't trouble you with because they're really of interest only to those in the procedural steps, except to note that there were two bodies principally established by the Native Title Act: the National Native Title Tribunal, the president of whom is here tonight, Raylene Webb, and the Federal Court, were established as the two entities that would have much to do with the administration and application of that Act. Again, if I move on a bit, because it's really historical, but many of you might like to understand it, the concepts of the Act were that you would get native title recognised if you could show three things. At settlement, and that settlement varied depending upon where it happened across Australia, but say 1788, there existed a society of Indigenous people who occupied that country according to traditional laws and customs. Secondly, that community had continued to exercise those rights over that country under their laws and customs until the time of the decision. So that there had to be that element of continuity. Many of you will know that the history of Australia's relationship with Indigenous people was to attempt to destroy that continuity, not in the sense of deliberately trying to destroy a native title, but because basically, paternalistically, we took children away, we encouraged people not to speak their languages, we took the children to different schools. All of those sort of processes had the effect of tending to destroy that continuity of practice which the Native Title Act required. And the third thing was that there had to be a community with the same lineage, if you like, practising that that traditional laws and customs at the time of the claim. And very quickly the court said the same laws and customs mean laws and customs evolved and adapted according to the needs and nature of society. So that hasn't proved to be a particularly significant aspect. Secondly, and you can see those cases mentioned there, secondly, to be able to establish native title, you had to get over the problem of extinguishment because it was subject to the Crown's radical title. If it was unoccupied Crown land, or if there was land where the Crown had not granted any interest to anybody else, that was easy. Your exclusive possession could continue, and there's been significant grants of that sort of land. But mostly, Australia had, through the Crown, been granted pastoral leases, mining leases, freehold, etc., etc. So what happened then was a number of decisions about the effect of extinguishment or the extinguishing effect of various grants of land. Fijo, pretty obviously now, said if you have granted a freehold, there are no native title rights left because freehold rights are entirely inconsistent with native title rights. WIC, which became a very politically unattractive decision to some people, but now seems to be obvious, so that if you have a pastoral lease that is not totally inconsistent with Indigenous rights continuing to exist, because the Indigenous Australians can still exercise many of their rights, they cannot exercise the right to exclude others because the pastoral lease lets others on. So that right is extinguished, but many of the other rights have persisted. WIC drew a lot of criticism from the media and from sections of society. The pastoralist community as a whole very quickly took it on board, and mostly the pastoral industry has now worked with and supported the recognition of Indigenous rights over their land. So they were perhaps ahead of the game in many ways. Mining interests were dealt with in Brown finally after a lot of interest, and I think Michael Barker and I were both involved in that in various ways. The High Court ultimately said, if you get a mining lease over, say, 1,000 square kilometres, does that extinguish native title? Because the mining lease permits the miner to go on to dig holes, to establish a town, to put in railways, to build roads, etc., etc. And the argument was, well, if you can do all that, then there's no room for Indigenous rights. And the High Court said that is not right, because you look at the nature of the rights which are granted. They're not going to dig a hole over 1,000 square kilometres. They're going to dig a hole there. And when that's known, that's an exercise of that right. But the right itself doesn't extinguish the entitlement of the Indigenous people to occupy that land just because it exists, because it's not inconsistent with the exercise of the Indigenous rights. And when they did dig a hole, then the exercise of the Indigenous rights were suppressed for the period of that hole being there. Most mining leases require, when the mine is finished or the lease expires, to restore, and then it can be re-enjoyed. So Brown was a very significant thing. And along the way, the third, I've dealt with those two and three, just come to four, just to mention it. Again, decisions of the court, largely opposed but now established principle, have established that the rights of Indigenous people, even if they're not exclusive rights, so they're non-exclusive rights, can include hunting, they can include fishing, including water rights, and they can include trading, commercial rights. And commercial rights, particularly in Paul Finn's decision in Akiba, which was upheld in the High Court, and then in a later decision of Borroloola, commercial trading rights have been recognised. So that was how the Native Title worked, Native Title Act worked. A couple of things I wanted to mention, particularly because it's important to the future. The first is, both in relation to extinguishment and in relation to compensation, there was a different regime for different periods. Before the Racial Discrimination Act 1975, there is no compensation. What is extinguished is extinguished. After the Racial Discrimination Act, there was an issue about the status of acts which were invalid but which had happened up until the commencement of the Native Title Act, pre-1975 to 92. So there was a regime built into the legislation and then picked up by the states to parallel it, about whether that act of extinguishment had an effect or not. Mostly it did. It's a very complicated set of legislation which you could read. It's almost like the Tax Act. You could read it for about 20 days and still not understand it. And importantly, if it was extinguished, then there was an entitlement to compensation. So in that interim period, if there was an act which happened to be invalid because of the Racial Discrimination Act, but which was validated by the validating acts passed at the same time as the Native Title Act, then you were entitled to compensation. So from 1975, there is a big issue about compensation, which is really an incipient issue. And then, of course, 1992 onwards, any act which was unlawful was unlawful, so you couldn't just do it. But there is a regime established in the Native Title Act for future acts. So if a government wants to give a mining licence, for example, on Aboriginal land where there are Indigenous rights, then there is a procedure by which notices are given, an opportunity to negotiate, and then a decision whether or not to allow that mining activity to to take place. That role is the role of the National Native Title Tribunal, and as you'll see in a minute, there's plenty of work for that to be done. Many people would say that it's a very difficult concept to allow, where there are Indigenous rights, the taking over of land once it has been recognised. Under the Land Rights Act, one of the significant pieces is that there is a veto. The Indigenous people have an absolute veto on allowing anything on their land. So if somebody finds a $200 billion gold mine on their land and the government says, we want to license someone to do it, and it's Land Rights Acting, there's just an absolute veto. That is not the case in relation to native title land recognised under the Land Rights Act. I should mention one other thing. There is a procedure apart from the processes of the courts to recognise native title, and that is the Indigenous Land Use Agreements, which the National Native Title Tribunal can register in circumstances prescribed, so you can resolve claims in two ways. So some statistics, if you find a little bit interesting, these have come from the Native Title Tribunal's website as at June 1917. So you can see the numbers. I might just mention in relation to no native title exists, it looks quite a lot. In New South Wales, there is a provision that entitles Indigenous people to get freehold interests in land, provided no native title exists, if there's a block of land in, say, Redfern that they think they can get hold of. If there is a determination that there is no native title in that block of land, then they can get the freehold, but it's a precondition. So there are quite a number of that 64 which are not New South Wales specific for a particular reason, so it doesn't look as bad as it is, and there are a significant number of registered agreements. The outstanding claim applications are quite significant. They've been evolving out as time goes because there is no time limit, so as you do, some more come in, and there's also a number in the Northern Territory where the claims were made over quite small areas because it's worked to the convenience of both of the Indigenous people and the pastoralists that the grant is made over each of a pastoral lease area rather than over the whole area of that community's society, so that's also a little bit misleading. And as I said, there's quite a lot of future Act applications which will require to be addressed. If you look at the picture, you can see South Australia, you can see where the words South Australia appear in the top left, that's the APY lands, and you can see that we have granted or addressed almost all of South Australia in the north above Port Augusta, and in the south all of the claims where the blue is are made and are being considered and progressively being addressed, including the Garner claim, which is of course a very complicated one because there's so much extinguishment because of the country. So almost all of South Australia is dealt with. The brown bit in between the green and the blue in South Australia is the subject of an agreement which was supported by the government, which also recognises Indigenous rights. If you look at Western Australia, you can see the dark green because that country, like the Northern Territory, has a lot of unalienated land available for exclusive determinations, and there have been a number of them. If you look in the bottom third of the Perth area, Perth and down that angled area there, there is the Western Australian government recently entered into an agreement for the recognition of Indigenous people in that whole area for a very considerable sum of money, and it's called the Noongar Settlement. So a number of communities got together and put that together. That's another achievement. So that's gone. You can see a very significant part of Australia is the subject of claims. In the Northern Territory, almost all of the white area is land rights. So that almost all of the Northern Territory will be the subject of, has been the subject of land rights determinations or will be the subject of native title applications. So if you look at the picture, the process is pretty good. And the thing I wanted to finish that part of the story with is a comment by Tom Carmer, just describing in 2010 how we changed the world of perception within the community. And in fact, those of you who've had the benefit of going to a native title consent determination will have seen the support of the farming industry, the support of the mining industry, and the support of governments for consent determinations, because they can operate together, they can use the Indigenous people for staff and quite senior staff, so it works as a complementary relationship where there is non-exclusive rights, and where there are exclusive rights, of course, it's very special. Now, let's make sure it doesn't jump to. So looking forward, where are we going? Where are our issues for the future? Well, I've dealt first with the recognition claims, the 249 claims that require to be addressed. The challenges are becoming more significant, because if you think about the connections, can you show that there was a society at settlement? Yes, you can, because there's anthropology, there's observations, there's historical evidence. Can you show continuity? It's getting harder because memory fails. I'm sure Frank will agree with me that the way in which the elders now relate to their country in many places is very different from what it used to be, because they've had 200 years plus of European settlement. They've had freehold land. The ceremonies have changed. The country's changed. The opportunity for ceremonies have changed. The people have changed. I know, because there are some people sitting in the room who were involved, I made a decision in relation to the Bangala people, that is the people on the York Peninsula running along the Gulf from Port Augusta down to Port Lincoln. And it was a very difficult claim to prove, because the people had been dispossessed. They were miners, they were businessmen, they were butchers, they were farmers themselves, and they were trying to preserve their culture, and a lot of them were struggling to show a degree of knowledge of traditional laws and customs to be able to maintain that, demonstrate that connection. The first case that I did involving native title as a judge, and Raylene was in the case at Davenport Ranges, Aluwara claim, the evidence of the people there, which is a remote area west of Tennant Creek, was, in comparative terms, quite spectacular. And you get spoiled a bit when you've seen the intensity of the relationship that these people had with their country, the way they were able to do ceremonies, the paintings that they could do as part of their relationships. And it was extraordinarily moving. And now, I think it's fair to say, that sort of thing is very rare. It's very rare because all of the easy claims, the more ones that more remote, where those sort of practices have been able to continue, have been done. We're now doing the more difficult claims. We have much less memory because we're now three generations away, or two generations away from the people in 1967. The memories are fading, the passing on of stories are fading. You hear stories of young people wanting to learn and going back to the books to learn. People like Lewis O'Brien, Uncle Lewis, are very valuable people, but they won't be here forever. So the time is a critical thing. It's a big challenge. How do we address that? Well, partly the anthropologists are critical in that role. Partly the judges have to understand that you have to make do with the evidence that is best there. And if it would be hard to say, there is no continuity unless it really was no continuity. If it's a wisp here and a wisp there and you make it, maybe that's enough. So you have to be sympathetic, maybe too sympathetic. Sometimes I find it hard to say because I was going to have a shot at Kaya Maher if he was here tonight, but he has a death in the family. But we've all been to places around the state where the politician will say, I recognise I'm in the land of the Pitjantjatjara people, I recognise I'm in the land of the Kaurna people, whatever. And you say in court, well, if you're recognising it, what's the problem? Why are you still fighting the claim? I don't say that in an unfair way to him, but I have said it in open court. But it is difficult to understand. They say, yes, we do. We represent the people as a collective. We have to be satisfied that it is the right people and so on. So it's a little bit of a problem. But anyway, and Bob French, when he was Chief Justice, suggested that one way to do that would be to apply a reverse onus of proof. That's been discussed so that the assertion is enough unless the government can disprove it. I think we probably don't need to do that because the process now is progressing pretty satisfactorily. Since 2009, the federal court is doing something like 50 or 60 consent determinations a year. And they're becoming more and more consent determinations, except now where there are intra-Indigenous issues, which are becoming a little bit more apparent. So looking forward, recognition claims are probably manageable with the right attitude from all parties. Compensation. I wanted to involve you a bit in this, if I may, and take a few minutes for the future. This is Timber Creek. You can see there, that is where the first contested compensation claim was decided. Incidentally, there are land rights claims on each of those big river mouths still to be decided. And they're very important because it's where the barramundi breed. And they're very, very heavily contested because if the Indigenous people get land rights over that, as they claim to be entitled to, there will be no commercial fishing and no recreational fishing without their approval in those very large areas of water. If you look at Timber, that area was all discovered by explored by Augustus Gregory in the 1870s. He came into Timber Creek along the Victoria River, a little place just north of Timber Creek, and he got off with his boat. Still quite a large river, well, probably twice as wide as this room. And his diary says, because crocodile-infested area, his diary says, I got off the boat, got on my horse, the horse trod on a crocodile. We stopped 3 kilometres later. Very laconic, very tough people who were those explorers. Anyway, Timber Creek involved compensation, and it was a compensation claim in respect of unlawful acts between 1975, the Racial Discrimination Act, and 1992. And there are about 20 properties ranging roughly between one hectare and 20 hectares in size, and all were found to be invalid. There was issues about the date of whether you valued the land at the date of validation or the date of the act. There were issues about interest. At the end of the day, that's probably not critically important. There is a provision in the Act which says you cannot give more compensation than the freehold value of the land. So the maximum is freehold. All of those pieces of land were non-exclusive, so it was a question of saying how much are the non-exclusive rights worth at the time of the invalid Act by reference to the freehold value, and then you allowed interest. The issue of solatium is the important part, I think. Mike, you'd agree with that, I think, wouldn't you? Solatium is special value, if you like, to the people who occupy the country, and that's available to you in Australian compulsory acquisition law for your value, but it's very hard to prove. In the case of Indigenous people on the country who have lost in an area, quite a big area, quite a lot of the land, but they're still living there, they're still living in their traditional ways with their traditional customs in many respects, they still have ceremony, but in different places. How do you make allowance for that? You hear old men who are the elders who say, this happened, it was taken away from me, I feel guilty. I was blamed because I was the elder person who was there and responsible for that country when that happened. And I've lived with that for 20 years, and I'm going to live with it for the rest of my life, and then my eldest son will live with it forever too. How do you compensate for that? What do you do? And then they say, well, look, you took an acre here and an acre here and an acre here, and it's all quite near the water, and in the middle was our ceremony ground. So You affected our ceremony. We can't have ceremonies there because there'll be someone there and someone there and someone there. It'll be too close. They'll hear the music, they'll hear the songs, they'll know the stories, they'll know the behaviours. So we've had to move our ceremony ground somewhere else. How do you account for that? And another place, one of the places which had been acquired, which was a big water tank, it was on a dreaming track. And the dreaming tracks, as you no doubt know, are terribly important. They're confined. This one was physically confined, but it was right in the middle of the dreaming track. So this story, the animal that was the subject of this story, could not continue because it was blocked. And that was terribly important to these people. Now, let's assume that you accept all that. What are you going to do? I had that pleasure or that challenge to award some damages for compensation for the solatium element just before I retired. 20 pieces of land, 10 years or 20 years in the past and 20 years or indefinitely in the future, and a break in a dreaming track forever. It is a very big judicial responsibility. I don't know what the right answer is. I'm pleased to say that Michael Barker and two other judges on that part of the judgment said that it wasn't wrong. I'm happy to tell him now how I worked it out. I didn't put that in the judgment, but it'll go to the High Court. The High Court will look at it. But it is a very real problem. And it's a real problem, probably an easier problem in a remote community where people are going to come along and say that, and you can see it. You know, I'm breastfeeding about that having happened. In cities, or where there's been less connection, where it is less remote, but there has been extinguishment since 1975 in a way that was unlawful, it may be a bit different because there'll be different considerations then, because those people probably wouldn't have been practicing and relating to the depth of their relationship with the country in the same way. Conceptually, they will still feel it, but there will not be that individual merit, sort of sense of accountability, because I suppose even though we look at Victoria Square and say that's the middle of Ghana country, I don't know, because I haven't heard evidence about whether there is a Ghana family who says, I feel terribly bad that that is there now, that I can't do anything about it. We've got roads through it and trams and so on. There may be that evidence, I don't know, but it will, I suspect, depend on the evidence. But it's just a very big challenge which we have to look and address in the future. And that leads to my final set of comments. I'm not too bad on time. Our rate of progress, I've mentioned that. The second thing is the internal accountability of Indigenous communities for what they receive, either because of the activities that they're allowed to carry out on their land or because of the compensation that they will get for land that they have unlawfully been deprived of since 1975. There may be different answers. In the case of receipt of funds for what they are entitled to receive for activities on their land, the interested people are the people that they are accountable to. And that is one of the challenges. One of the traditional, not traditional, but conventional rule is that you are Aboriginal if you are able to trace your ancestry or your descent from the Aboriginal community that has that area. And there's a sort of a rule of thumb that says 1/16th and then you drop out, but that's not legislated. Secondly, you have to self-identify as an Aboriginal person, and that is becoming much more common now because a lot of people find about their Aboriginal heritage and are very proud of it, which is a wonderful thing. And thirdly, there is a process of self-acceptance or acceptance by the group. That's more problematical. Because if somebody who is now a young Aboriginal person who says, I want to be part of your group, is it right that a particular small section of that community should be able to exclude that person from that group? When we are adapting traditional laws and customs, as has happened in a fairly sophisticated way over the last many years, We are getting in the courts more disputes about whether someone is or is not a member of the family, whether a family is or is not related to the ancestral forebears. Some of you in the room will also, I put the Lake Torrens claim there. It isn't quite on the point, but it's an interesting exercise. Lake Torrens in the South Australian map that you saw was a little bit just to the west of the Flinders Ranges, which involved a claim by three different groups for the same lake. And there had been a time when the three groups had got together and said, we can do this as one nominal group, and nearly got to the point of agreement, then it fell through. So there were three different groups all claiming occupation of the one lake. That matter is still the subject of an appeal, but it shows the capacity for the Indigenous communities themselves now to ventilate disputes more than they used to in the courts. Another example is a case that also started with me but is now being run by somebody else, again with the Yirrkala people, who are getting large royalties. There is now a dispute between the three groups of Aboriginals who form the group where that mining is, and who are sharing in the royalties because they want a different split up of the money. And they're chasing, they come to the court to get that. They complain about the Northern Land Council, which has made the decision, and there is a whole lot of interesting background, which I won't tell you about. If you want to talk about it, I'm happy to describe it to you. But just the fact of that dispute being in the court shows that the question of accountability is a significant one. And then there's another issue about elders, because we've evolved in a way from elders. There was a time, particularly in the Northern Territory, where a lot of the old men were not performing their roles, and a lot of the old women who never did started to. And I think it's a generally observed comment. Thank heaven that the old women did what they did a lot, because they were more conservative in preserving the behaviour of the traditional community. But is it the elders who should be making those decisions? Is it a democratic vote? Recently, again, when a very significant Ilua land use agreement came to be registered, there was a complaint about that because the vote which had produced the outcome of the Aboriginal community to sign the agreement was not unanimous, and it was said that there was a requirement for it to be unanimous. When one looked at the provisions, it was unanimous. It was required to be unanimous, so the agreement was not allowed to be registered. Very prompt legislative response saying it doesn't have to be unanimous. So legislation in that context producing a degree of democratic voting about it. How are we going to do that? So that's an issue that we have to address. And the other issue is the management of funds which are received. Now, it seems to me that if it's Indigenous people receiving funds for use of their land, it is their business. But they have to be accountable to their group. A lot of that is a difficult process. It is done through the land councils. It is done through audits. But it still involves a degree of accountability. One illustration, which is a very small illustration in terms of money, was where a group was given $300,000 to permit a bridge to be built over part of their land, over part of a river, over part of their land. What did they do with it? Well, the four elders took it and spent it. Is that our business? Whose business is it? What about the other people who are younger who didn't know about it, or the other people in the group who didn't get any of it? Should it be put in for education? Should it? So, and Timber Creek itself gives an example now, because there is one point, apart from the land itself, there is $1.4 million, which is Salatium money. Salatium money has a particular character, as I've described to you, because of its character. Do we as a community or have a right or an interest in ensuring that it is preserved, because it is in respect of the loss of something which is permanent? It is a very poor substitute for the loss of some relationship which is permanent. But because it has that character, should it be preserved in a way that gives that community something longer term, or should we just leave it to that to be administered in that way? So when you get to compensation, I think there is a room for a debate at least about who is accountable and to whom for the management of those funds. If it is compensation money, I think there is not a bad position to say that is something for which they are accountable, not just to the existing but to the future members of the society. Now, where are we? There's a few issues in the overall picture of things. Native title is being recognised at an appropriate rate now, although it was very slow to get going. There are some new challenges. And of the issues that I've spoken to you about, and which I thought about quite a bit, I'm pleased to now take a step which is a little bit further. You all know about the Mutajulu meeting and the referendum council that emerged from that, the proposal for a parliamentary voice for Indigenous peoples. You would know that Noel Pearson is one of the drivers of that concept, as is Warren Mundine and Professor Marcia Langton, all of whom were part of the team who negotiated and brought the Aboriginal community together to introduce the Native Title Act. It wasn't just Liberal against Labor, it was Indigenous against Australia, non-Indigenous, and they were part of that compromise process, and they're still there to their great credit. But what they've done, consistently, I think, with what I was putting to you about the difficulties of saying how you manage what comes out of it, is this: their referendum council proposal is to establish a parliamentary voice. It does not say how to identify the voice. It does not say what the functions of the body which is to identify the voice of the Indigenous people are to do. It is not saying what those structures are. It is not saying what the procedures are to establish those structures. So having reached what I thought were fairly ambiguous conclusions about the remaining amorphous issues, I was very pleased to see that the referendum council proposition is to say, we need a voice, establish the concept of a parliamentary voice, and then we'll figure out how we're going to give it to you. And that is really the answer that I have. Now, let me conclude by saying two things. The final sentence of Frank Bennen's book in 1995 reads, "The High Court decision and the Native Title Act are the reconciling pillars for the bridge that will provide recognition and justice for those on both sides of the river, that is, Aboriginal Australians and settler Australians. If," he said, "if we were to complete the bridge by 2001, all Australia could be confident that, whatever the differences, both sides of the river are part of one land, one nation." Well, we're not there yet, even 15 years on, but we are, I think, not too far away. And in that context, it is significant, I think, to remind ourselves that at the funeral of Justine Diamond in Minneapolis last Friday, her Australianness was represented by the playing of the didgeridoo. Thank you.
Thank you, John, for an amazing lecture. For those of you who know John well, it probably comes as no surprise that he was actually reluctant to have a lecture series named after him. However, we outvoted him on the advisory board, despite the fact that he chairs that board. And he has been a wonderful friend and mentor of the law school and the university, and it is our great honour that you have lent your name to this lecture series, John. And I'd just like to publicly acknowledge the work of Maggie Ball in organising tonight. She's done a remarkable job pulling this all together, as I'm sure John would attest. And I'd also like to thank the support, or acknowledge the work that Leanne Steele has done in pulling this together as well. It was initially Leanne's idea to start this lecture series in your name, and what a great idea it was, Leanne. So we have a small gift just to acknowledge our appreciation and thanks for lending your name. And I would also like to join with the rest of the audience in just saying thank you for delivering such a fantastic presentation, and we look forward to celebrating this event on an annual basis. So thank you, John.